Welcome to Impact OC, the only program showcasing the people and organizations shaping Orange County, with your host, Don Camber.
Hello, live from the OC Talk Radio studios at UCI's Beal Applied Innovation Center. I'm OC Talk Radio Public Affairs Director Don Camber with another great guest impacting our community in a positive way. Today, I welcome Orangewood Foundation Chief Executive Officer Chris Simonson. The organization is the leading provider of services to teens and young adults in Orange County, many of whom have spent time in the foster care system, are struggling with homelessness, and or are survivors of human trafficking. Thank you, Chris, for being on Impact OC.
I'm excited to be here. Thanks for having me.
Chris, please share with us the demographics of the youth you help and their life circumstances.
Sure. So primarily, Orangewood Foundation focuses on teens and young adults. So the little children are handled more by Orange County Social Services. Our support is really with the teens to help prepare them for their future when they leave foster care, and also with young adults who have left the foster care system and many times are struggling to sustain themselves and create a path for themselves into the future.
Now, did Orangewood have a different name before?
Well, there is confusion in the community with the Orangewood Children's Home. Our organization started with a project back in the 1980s to build an emergency shelter for foster youth in conjunction with the county. It was a public-private partnership, and General William Lyon led a fundraising campaign to build the facility. And that project was completed in 1985, and the Orangewood Children's Home was opened. At that time, the facility was donated back to the county, and the county has run and operated that emergency shelter ever since 1985. But the board that had gotten together to do this project realized how much support foster youth need as they go through foster care, and when they leave foster care, that they said, let's continue on with our nonprofit. And it was called Orangewood Children's Foundation. And let's create programs to support young people in foster care, and especially those when they leave foster care. And that's what we've been doing over the last 35 years, is creating and adding programs to support those young people.
So is there a connection between the foster youth and that home, or are they two separate entities?
They're two separate entities. The county runs the emergency shelter, and our foundation is a 501c3. We do see youth from that facility from time to time. We do activities over there to support them, but our main responsibilities are the programs that we've created ourselves to support the teens and young adults.
And let's talk about your programs, because the whole thing is to help youth transition from foster care to independent adulthood.
Right. We focus on four core service areas: health and wellness, life skills and employment, housing, and education. And we've got probably 13 to 14 different programs that focus on one or more of those areas. And we serve a broad spectrum of young people. So some of our young people that we serve are struggling on the streets. They're homeless. They have no place to live. And they're coming into our drop-in center and working with our team there, first just to get a warm meal, a shower, the basic essentials. And then once we build a relationship with them, then we can start talking to them about, okay, what are your goals? How can we help you? Let's look at employment. Let's look at housing. Each case is very unique. There's no playbook on this is how you help a young person succeed. And they have to first trust that Orangewood Foundation is a safe place where they can talk to our staff and feel like no one's going to judge you here. We're just going to provide the support you need to accomplish the things that you want to get accomplished. And some have lofty goals, and we do have, on the other end of the spectrum, superstars that we've provided college support to that are getting their master's and their PhDs. And that might not seem super impressive on the surface, but when only 2% of foster youth graduate college, to then have some that are going on and getting advanced degrees, those young people have really overcome some amazing obstacles to get to that point.
So are you saying that there's some teens who want to remain on the streets?
Well, you know, homelessness is a complicated issue, and some of the young people that we work with, they feel a sense of community with others that are homeless, and they can't picture themselves in any other situation. So we don't force them into housing. We, like I said, the first thing we need to do is build that relationship. And then when they start coming back, and sometimes on a daily basis, to get food from us and to get a shower, then we can start asking them about, well, aren't you getting tired of sleeping in your car or sleeping on the streets? And, you know, we do have some housing options that we can explore with you. And you know, hopefully eventually they'll come around, and most do. But it takes time sometimes.
So where do you offer this food and showers and help?
Well, we have a drop-in center at our main office on 17th Street in Santa Ana. And all of the resources that I talked about, food, clothing, we get clothing donations from Tilly's. They're a great partner of ours. We have a shower there. We also have mental health services that we offer on site. We have employment services, computers they can use. They can get their mail sent to our drop-in center. So that drop-in center is a place for any young person, primarily 18 to 25 year olds, to come and just see how we can help them. They don't have to have had a history in foster care. We serve any young person that is in need. And there's no barriers to coming and talking to us and seeing how we can support them.
Are there primarily young women, young men?
We have a mix of men and women. We do have a separate drop-in center for young ladies primarily that are survivors of human trafficking or at risk of being trafficked. We have a contract with the County of Orange to provide those services to young people in a confidential drop-in center space and try to understand what their situation is. Maybe they're just at risk of being trafficked, or in some cases they are being currently trafficked, or they had been trafficked for a couple years and now are trying to reestablish themselves as their own person. You know, there's a misconception that human trafficking is pimps and prostitutes, and those young ladies get to keep the money that they get from their johns, but that's not the case at all. Their pimp gets all that money. They treat them horribly. There's a lot of trauma and abuse that goes on in that relationship. And, you know, people ask, well, why do they stay there? You know, and it's extremely challenging for them to leave those situations, especially if they're getting moved all over the West Coast from city to city, and they've maybe had their families threatened. There's a lot of situations there. So that drop-in center that we have is really geared towards the specialized services and support that population needs.
Let's talk about some of your programs. You offer housing. Explain.
So we have four housing programs. Two of them are in apartment complexes where we have partnered up with some men from Mariners Church back in 1999. We bought these apartment complexes, and 10 of the units there we lease out for our young people to live in. The other 60 or 70 are rented to the general public, low-income housing units. But the unique thing about this program and the model is that all of the money that those two apartment complexes generate don't go to the owners. They are a nonprofit, so they donate all of those funds back to Orangewood Foundation so we can pay for the staffing and all the support for the young people that we have on site. So it's a self-sustaining business model. Then we have a new program that we are just about to launch for young moms and their young babies, 0 to, say, 3 years old. That's the biggest housing need Orange County has right now, is for young moms. And we saw that with the young people we serve. So we converted one of our homes that we owned that was serving young girls coming out of foster care to shift that to young moms, because the young girls, we were able to move them into other housing options, including some of ours, but also HUD, the federal agency, has created a new voucher program specifically for former foster youth, and the county is starting to get those vouchers. And we've partnered up with United Way in the county on that initiative, and that's been extremely successful. And then we do have a housing program dedicated to survivors of human trafficking. So all of the residents of that program are coming out of a human trafficking situation, and so we have specialized staff and support for them.
Let's talk about the clients that you're dealing with. They were in foster care, and now what? So tell us what they're going through.
Yeah, so the majority of the young people we serve spent some time in the foster care system. And just that in and of itself lets you know that they experienced trauma in their childhood, neglect. They were moved around a lot, whether it was throughout their biological family or to foster families or to other facilities. They moved schools constantly. So it is a very challenging environment for any young child to grow up in when you're moving around all the time and you don't have that stable family network to support you. And some young people, children, get adopted, but once you make it into your teen years, your chances of adoption are very low. And so that's where we step in to work with the teenagers to start helping them put together a transition plan coming out of foster care, make sure they graduate high school, because only 2/3 of foster youth graduate high school. And then once they do that, okay, what's the plan after graduation? Do you want to go on to college? Do you want to get involved in a career? You know, let's figure out what your housing options are going to be. Because if you could imagine as an 18-year-old in your own life, having all your belongings packed up and someone telling you, okay, you're on your own, you need to go find a place to live, you need to figure out where you're going to work to pay for that place, and maybe go to school at the same time. Most of these young people don't have cars, so, you know, how do you get to and from school or your job with no family support? I mean, that's just a very challenging and probably unrealistic thing that we're asking these young people to do. Now, California has provided young people the option of extending their stay in foster care to age 21 and providing them a housing stipend of around $900. So that has helped, but it's still a lot to ask for a young person to do all that on their own. And that's where Orangewood Foundation comes in with all of our programs and supports.
How are you able to connect with them? How do you know about them?
So we have a program with the county called the Independent Living Program. And at age 15 and a half, any young person that's in foster care is referred over to us to start working with us in that program. We offer 4 to 5 workshops a month on various topics. And then we also can assign them a case manager to just help them with everything else. For example, when they're becoming seniors in high school, helping them apply for colleges, fill out their FAFSA, all the things that parents would normally help them with. We can help them with all those things. If they don't come through that independent living program, maybe they're older and they were in foster care and now they're 19 or 20. A lot of those young people come to us just through word of mouth. Their friends have been to our resource center, so they let them know, hey, this is a place that I go that's safe, and they help me. So that's where we get our referrals for the older young adults.
And who are the staff that helps them?
Well, our team is incredible. We've got about 80 staff people across our organization, not counting the staff over at our charter school, Samueli Academy. And they're just people with a great heart that want to help young people. You know, they all have their degrees in human services or psychology or social work or advanced degrees. And they just have a passion for what we do. I mean, that's the one thing about our organization that I'm really proud of, is everyone that works at Orangewood Foundation is so focused on our mission of helping young people. When everyone's rowing the boat the same way, it makes your organization run really well and really achieve the results that you're trying to, which is providing as much support as we can to our young people.
And of course, in order for it to succeed, the young person has to want to go through the program.
You're right. There are some young people that have been in and out of our programs for years. And, you know, sometimes they're engaged and they're really motivated and driven. But, you know, their upbringing has caused them a lot of psychological damage. And their decision-making process and their thought process is not always firing on all cylinders. And they make poor decisions. And sometimes they'll use substances, for example, to, you know, help them overcome some of the trauma that they're feeling, in, or depression or mental illness. And, you know, and then they'll come back. They're always welcome back. We never exclude anyone or kick anyone out. Sometimes we don't see someone for a year or two, and then I'll just bump into them downstairs in the resource center and, hey, how you doing? He said, oh, well, not so good. That's why I came back. I need help. And yeah, it's, but our team is fantastic. They just really know how to connect with young people and, like I said, build those trusting relationships that are so important.
How can the public help you?
Well, you know, we couldn't do what we do without our community. And, you know, some people think that all we need is more money to do things. But, you know, we need volunteers to cook in our kitchen, for example, so we can serve meals every day to our young people. We have volunteers that work at our youth events or our fundraising events. One of our biggest needs right now is, I mentioned our charter school, Samueli Academy. It's 7th through 12th grade, and it serves, it's in Santa Ana and serves the community. Foster youth automatically get enrolled in the school because that's our mission, and that's why we started the school, was to get more foster youth through high school. The unique thing about our school is we just opened up an on-campus dormitory for our foster youth students. And this is the first program of its kind in California where the young people, the students, would live during the week in our dormitory. And then on the weekends, we would place them with a foster family so they could build that family relationship. So it takes some burden off of the foster families during the week with all the academic work. And, you know, we can handle that on campus. And then on the weekends and the breaks and summer vacation, they can build those relationships. So we are in need of foster families to go through our Youth Connected program, is what it's called. We need to license more foster families so then we can get more placements from the county and get more people through this unique program. We're really excited about it, and we think it's going to really be a difference maker in giving our foster youth students at Samueli Academy a lot of stability and a lot of support, and also making the commitment from a foster family something they can ease into. It's not a 24/7 commitment right out of the gate. It's something that they can get used to one another, build that relationship, and then the goal over time, after some period of months or a year, is maybe they don't need to come on campus anymore and they can just stay full time with the foster family. So that's another way that people can get involved. We do have a holiday drive every year, and we thank the community for all the support they do in filling the wish list for all of our young people. We need mentors. We have a mentoring program, which is a one-on-one relationship with a young person. So there's all sorts of things on our website and about different ways to get involved.
Give us the website address.
Sure. It's www.orangewoodfoundation.org. So pretty simple.
What are the requirements to be a foster family involved with the Orangewood Foundation?
Yeah, you need to go through some training. You need to be licensed through the county and through Orangewood Foundation. It takes about 60 to 90 days to go through all of that. You need to have a suitable place for the young person to live in your home. And they inspect your home just to make sure it's safe. But it's not too onerous. And most people will tell you it's very rewarding to be involved in a foster youth's life and to support them and give them the love and the care that they need.
Can it be a single parent doing it?
It can be a single parent. It can be a gay gay couple, it doesn't really matter. I mean, as long as you have the capacity to care for somebody and you have space in your home, then there's background checks, of course, but as long as there's nothing in your past that would prevent you from having a foster youth, no, anyone's welcome.
What are the most important skills that the foster youth get from your program?
Well, you know, a lot of times we have people come up and say, oh my God, you know, you've done such a great job with this young person. Like, I can't believe everything that they've accomplished because of Orangewood Foundation. And in reality, it's always up to the young person themselves. They have to dig deep and have the desire and the initiative to accomplish what they want to accomplish. We really just walk by their side and provide them the supports they need when they struggle, when they fail, when they need financial support, when they need, you know, just someone to talk to. That's really what we do well. I'd like to think that, you know, when a young person is done working with us, they're more trusting of people. They've got a better self-esteem and they feel good about what they can accomplish. And they've developed some core basic skills around relationships and finances and the things that we teach them that'll carry them on in their adult life.
So you believe that it's the life skills that they gain that will help them become really accomplished adults?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of us learn those things, whether we realize it or not, as we're growing up with our parents, and they're teaching us the basics and the essentials, and we pick up on those things and build that skill set over our teenage years. When a foster youth is bouncing around from home to home and school to school, development of that skill set is not always there. And so we really work hard on getting them to realize where they could improve their skills and then help them develop those skills, because all of us need a certain basic level of skills in certain areas to be successful adults.
Thank you, Orangewood Foundation Chief Executive Officer Chris Simonson, for being on Impact OC. And I thank everyone for tuning in. I'm OC Talk Radio Public Affairs Director Dawn Camber. Have an impactful day.
You've been listening to Impact OC, the only program showcasing the people and organizations shaping our community. Right here on Orange County's only community radio station, OC Talk Radio.